مساء الخير. أنا أولاً بشكر السادة المنظمين دعوتي للمؤتمر الجميل دهوت. و it's my pleasure to share this session with my colleague دكتور شريف عبد الوهاب and دكتور أحمد. دكتور وحيد, it's my honor to present you. أنا ما قابلتش حضرتك شخصياً, لكن كلنا نعرف مين دكتور وحيد طنطاوي, ولما نفكر في أي CT guided biopsy صعبة بنكتب على روشيتا دكتور وحيد طنطاوي. دي حقيقة. It's my pleasure to introduce you for your talk. Guided lung biopsy and ablation tips and tricks. تفضل.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Thank you many for the introduction. Thank you for all arrangement of this prestigious conference. My talk today is about guided lung biopsy and lung tumor ablation. I have no conflict of interest or disclosures. As you know, tissue acquisition and biopsy can be performed by surgery or alternatively by image-guided percutaneous needle biopsy, which is less invasive with less mortality and morbidity. We can get fine needle aspiration or core biopsy, but a combination of both gives the best results. Usually we do our biopsy in the presence of a cytopathologist, binepteidable fine needle aspiration, and just go ahead and see what we have gotten. If it's hypocellular or necrotic, we change the position of our needle until we get viable representative tissue for what we expected radiologically. And we also add cell blocks from the aspirate for immunostaining. Then afterwards, when we reach an area which we confirm that it has viable tissue, we start getting our core biopsy using automatic biopsy gun. This core biopsy is imprinted. بنزحفها على السلايد عشان نتأكد إن الكور ده is having a good amount of cells, viable tissue for immunohistochemistry and other genetic examinations. So after that, we get more than one core to make sure that the tissue is enough for further studies. The big lesions are easy. Sorry, video مش شغال. مش عارف ليه. المفروض كان شغال. Anyway, we for the big peripheral masses, it can be biopsied by CT scan or by ultrasound. دي صورة الالتراساوند, المفروض النيدل تبقى باينة and you see your target while you are getting your biopsy. Although these big lesions appear easy to get biopsy, however, the problem is most of those masses are necrotic masses. So you need to الفيديو مش شغالة, المفروض انها شغالة كانت, انا جربتها بره. هي دي ultrasound examination برضو for this big mass. أنا ممكن أستخدم الكمبيوتر بتاعي لو الدنيا مش شغالة. أنا كنت لسه مجربها قبل ما نبتدي بس كانت شغالة. طب نرجع كده ثاني يمكن تشتغل. طيب كويس. دي النيدل, you can see it directly. الالتراساوند has advantage ان هو بتشوف in a real time النيدل وهي داخله. The other point is that you can see the big vessels فما تعملهمش injury وانت داخل البيوبسي فدي دي advantages بتشوفها بالدوبلر طبعا. والحاجة التانية it directs you to the viable tissue having high velocity flow inside and shows the highest grade of the tumor you can get into. فزي ما بنقول المشكلة في الماسز البريفرال دي ان بيبقى فيها جزء نكروتيك بدأنا نعرفه بالالترا سام بالدوبلر زي ما شفنا كده بالهاي فيلوستي انسايد، وبنقدر كمان بالسي تي نغير الويندو والليفل بتاعها. الهاي دنسيتي اريا از يوجوالي فايبل، او الاريا اللي فيها انهانسمنت لو بوست كونتراست زي كده بيبقى فايبل. البيست دلوقتي اللي احنا بنجايد بيه هو البيت سي تي. البيت سي تي شوينج ذا هاي اس يو في فاليوز ان ذا موست فايبل تيشو. فبالتالي ال area of necrosis في الميدل is not getting any activity. اكتر حتة فيها activity هي دي، ودي اللي احنا خدنا منها البيوبسي. Other advantage للبت انه you can choose different areas than some risky areas زي الـ هنا في this lesion is more central. فهنخش جوه اللنج ونخش جوه، لكن الـ هنا لقينا في نفس البيشنت في extra pulmonary chest wall metastasis بالالتراساوند سهل انها تاخد من غير ما نخش جوه اللنج خالص. You can get a very good representative tissue. فبالتالي بتدايركت يو للليست انفيزيف areas او least risky. السي تي جايد بايوبسي از ذا مين ستاي لسه، يعني most of the lesions are usually intraparenchymal. There is some general rules we have to abide. يعني لو تقدر ما تخشش جوه اللنج خالص يبقى احسن. فلو هي peripheral في peripheral وcentral زي الكيس دي، بدل ما اخش في الناحيه اللي فيها deep lesions بخش في المور peripheral، بالذات لو في زي atelectasis او pseudopods او infiltration to the pleura بخش من خلالها عشان اقلل الريسك اوف نيوموثوراكس. العيان ده انفيزيمتس لو بصينا كويس فوق الماس مليانه انفيزيمتس بولي، وفي تاجز انتو ذا بلورا. ثرو ذيس تاجز قدرنا ناخد البيوبسي من غير ما نعمل نيوموثوراكس، بنحاول نلاقي طريق. السنترال ليجنز ما لهاش حل غير انك انت بتروح ترانسبالمونري و تاخد بالك بس بنمد الاول الفاين نيدل واتاكد ان وانا بقطع المسافه دي ما فيهاش فيسلز كبيره عشان ما يحصلش هيرويك هيموج. افويد بولي اند انفيزيمتس اريا، ده العيان كله انفيزيمتس اريا، فيعني از ا فيري ريسكي بيشنت. انما لقينا حته فيها اتلكتسيز وثرو ويتش يو كان ريتش ذا ماس اند تيك يور بايوبسي. الحاجة التانية بنحاول ما نخشش في الفيشرز، يعني المفروض ان الاريا القريبة هنا هي البوستيريور كده اخش دايركت كده، لكن كده اي ويل ترافيرس الفيشر وده بي انكريز النيوموثوراكس 16 تايم. فبنخش بارلل للفيشر ان بوسترولاترال دايركشن من غير ما فيوليت الفيشر، فبالتالي بنقلل النيوموثوراكس. الليست اريا اقرب مكان بخش فيه هو ده المكان اللي انا بعدي منه، ويوجوالي افويد الترانسكشن بتاع الفيسلز عشان ما حصلش هيموريدج. ببقى بارلل الفيسلز زي ما احنا شايفين هنا، انا بارلل الفيسلز مش قاطعها علشان ما ازودش الانسيدنس اوف نيوموثوراكس. الـ reduce الـ re-entry time أنا بقى aim precisely، وبعدين one prick أخش جوه علشان لو زودت كل ما بزود بزود الـ risk of pneumothorax. في بعض الـ lesions small أو near to the diaphragm دول بيبقى الـ incidence of pneumothorax فيها أعلى، فممكن أستخدم حاجة اللي هي الـ CT fluoroscopy. multiple frames سراع قوي ورا بعض في خلال بتقدر تشوف النيدل وهي داخلة، إنما at expense إن إيديك بتتعرض وإنت بتتعرض أكتر والعيان بيتعرض أكتر. فبنستخدمها very limited للحالات الصعبة ولازم محتاجة experience and training. الميدياستاينال بايوبسي الانتيريور ليجنز يوجوالي وي جو ان ا باراسترنال لوكيشن، نخلي بالنا قوي من الاسهم الصاهمين الصغيرين دول الانترنال ماموري فيسلز اللي بيستخدموهم في الكاردياك باي باس، لانه الانجري بتاعهم بيعمل هيرويك هيموريج، دايما بنحاول نبعد عنهم وناخد اور بايوبسي. البوستيريور ليجنز زي سب كراينال، كنا زمان بنخش ترانس بالمونري بنعدي من ناحيه لناحيه، وده بينكريز الانسيدنس برضو اوف ذا نيو ثوراكس. احنا نشرنا بيبر عن الاكسترا بلورال بارافيرتيبرال سي تي جايدنس، بنخش عن طريق الفاشيا الثوراسيك فاشيا اكسترا بلورال وباراليل للفيرتيبرا، ما بين الفيرتيبرا والبلورا في فاشيا، بنخش جوه الفاشيا دي في الناحيه اليمين، بنافويد ان احنا نعدي على السمول ستراكشر ده اللي هو الازايجوس فين، والبيجر ستراكشر على الناحيه الشمال اللي هو الاورت، ممكن نزقه شويه بس ما نخشش جواه. في بعض الاحيان بنضطر نخش جواه نو بروبلم قوي لو بالفاين نيدل، بس بالكور ما نقدرش. وناخد من السب كراينال ليمف نود فور اكزامبل او وات ايفر بوستيريور ليجنز ان ذات واي. الطريقه الثانيه ان لو انا عايز اخد كور بوسع، بعمل وايدنينج للسبيس ده بان انا انجكت سالاين، زي ما احنا شايفين طول ما انا داخل بانجكت سالاين، انجكت اوسع المسافه دي وبعدين اوصل للسبكراين الليمف نود وناخد البايوبسي فيها. الكومبليكيشنز نيوموثوراكس هيموريج فازوفيجال، فازوفيجال عادي بنرفع الرجلين بس اتس دينجرس، يعني لو لازم ناخد بالنا ان بعض بالذات الفيميلز ممكن يحصل لهم سيفير هايبوتنشن، فبنرفع الرجلين وندي افيدرين واتروبين. الهيموريجز اولذو ماتش ليس فريكوينت عن النيوموثوراكس انما ات كان بي ديفاستيتنج، فاول ما يحصل هيموريج بنديها كابرون يعني سام سبورتيف دراجز ومعاهم ممكن بارنترال فلويدز. لو هو سيفير هيموريج لازم يبقى احنا دايما بنشتغل ومعانا دكتور تخدير، ما بشتغلش الا دكتور تخدير معايا، بيركب عنده تركيال تيوب ويبتدي يشفط وبنايم العيان على نفس الناحيه عشان ما يحصلش دريبلينج بتاع البلاد على الناحيه الثانيه، يبقى الناحيتين اتقفلوا. وفي بعض الاحيان يعني فيري ريرلي ممكن تحتاج اي سي يو، فيري رير يعني ما حصلتش الا مره واحده ان 35 years الحمد لله. النيوموثوراكس از مور كومون، 40% على الأقل بيحصل لهم نيوموثوركس، إنما 90 to 95% of those are mild. فالمايلد دول بس بنتابعهم بحيث إن هو if it's not increasing بيروح بيتهم، فإحنا بنتابع الفولو أب ساعة كل ساعة نبص عليه وهو قاعد معنا في الفاسيليتي، وبعدين لحد ما يوصل ان هو بعد 2 or 3 days completely absorbed. ف 95% مش محتاج اي حاجه، we treat them conservatively. المودريت اند سيفير وي هاف تو اسبايريت تو ذا سي في بلاستيك سي في بي بلاستيك كانيولا، بنركب الكانيولا وبنسحب الاير وبعدين نخلي العيان اندر سوبرفيجن برضو كل ساعه نبص عليه، ولو ما زادش تاني او ري اكيوميليتنج خلاص بيروح وبيجي تاني يوم نبص عليه. لو ري اكيوميليتنج رابيدلي او هي سيفير من البيجيننج زي العيان ده انفيزيمتس جدا، وانا كنت منبه اهله ان ممكن نحتاج ان احنا نركب له تيوب، اتعمل له البايوبسي انستانتينيسلي راح حصل له سيفير نيوموثوركس، الاكسجين ساتوريشن وطي جدا و هو بقى ديسنيك، متركب له بيك تيل كثر وسحبنا الهواء وبعدين بنوصلها بنستخدم سينجل بانشر بيك تيل على طول، بنركبها في ثواني وبعدين وان واي فالف ونفولو البيشنت اب لحد ما نعمل ويننج. بعد كده لو هو الريلاتيفز انتليجنت او معاه هوم نيرسينج بنروحه على البيت، لو they are not بنوديه مستشفى يوم او اتنين. وده مثلا 1% of the number of the whole number of cases we need to do that. In conclusion, for this part of lecture, image-guided lung biopsy offers to the clinician and patients low-cost, safe way for cell and tissue diagnosis with high accuracy reaching 95% and material usually enough for immunophenotyping, molecular tumor markers, and prognostic factor analysis for further therapy planning. The other part of the lecture is about the ablation of the lung tumors. Usually, surgical resection is the prime treatment for those either primary or metastatic lung disease. However, a large group of those cases are not surgically fit due to poor cardiopulmonary function, advanced age, or medical comorbidities. For those, external beam irradiation or SBRT are offered, but some of these cases are resistant to radiation and does not respond to chemotherapy. Here we offer the percutaneous image guided tumor ablation for those cases to help eradicating the disease or as much as we can. Many thermal ablative methods are used, radio frequency, microwave, laser, cryo ablation, irreversible electroporation. The latter, irreversible electroporation, lists تحت research. Laser with cryo ablation is very expensive and has a lot of hassle in preparation. So we left usually internationally with the radio frequency microwave with a very small role for laser and the cryo ablation. And radio frequency ablation is the widely used ablative technique all over for solid malignancies, but especially for the lung, we use more the microwave ablation because it has a better conviction of heat into the lung with less impedance and less heat sinking. مشكله الابليشن ان لو انت جنب artery او vein الحراره بتهرب من الابليتيف ميثود اللي انت بتستخدمها into those arteries and veins, فبالتالي الجزء القريب منهم ما بيتحرقش كويس. ده مش موجود في الميكروويف, عشان كده استخدام الميكروويف في اللانج is much better. هو كان much more expensive عن الراديو فريكونسي, بس الاسعار هبطت لما دخلت الصين وكوريا في الموضوع ب very good الحقيقه instruments و same quality, فقللت الاسعار قوي بتاعت المايكروويف. Whom you can do, who is qualified, اي عيان ممكن تعمل له سي تي guided biopsy بنفس ال constraints you can do الابليشن. الانديكيشنز A, poor surgical candidates for stage 1 or 2 non-small cell carcinoma, secondary to medical comorbidities, poor cardiopulmonary reserve or refusal to surgery or local recurrence post-surgery. برضو بالنسبة للميتاستاسيس, the two groups دول are more curative than palliative. فالpulmonary metastasis برضو medical comorbidities أو difficult أو impossible to resect lesions. لو عيان عنده كذا metastasis في كذا لوب, العيان ده بيبقى صعب يتعمل له surgery لأنك أنت هتريديوس الريزيديوال فوليوم بتاع اللنج بكمية كبيرة, فده is a good candidate for thermal ablation. المالتيبل metastasis developed بعد البرايمري على طول ما عمل لسه عامل surgery أو after pneumonectomy. البيست results ب 5 ليجنز, لو احنا بنتكلم عن ميتاستاسيس 5 ليجن او فيور و ليس ذان 5 سنتيمتر, اكتر من كده بيبقى البوسيبيليتي اوف كومبليت كيور از ديفيكال. الاذر انديكيشن از مور اوف بالياتيف اور هيلبينج كيمو اند ريديو ثيرابي. البالياتيف تريتمنت تو كنترول بين هيموبتيسيس انتراكتابل كاف او ايرسكتابل كيسز أو to reduce the tumor burden, نقلل حجم التيومر, فبالتالي you get better response combining radio and chemotherapy with the thermal ablation. This is a case of cancer colon with two recurrent bilateral pulmonary resistant metastasis, الناحية اليمين, precise direction, and then go into the lesion. دول دي واحدة من أوائل الحالات السهلة اللي كان اللي عملناها. بعد كده العملية بقت أصعب شوية. دايما في الأول الواحد يختار الحالات السهلة. ده كان يمكن من 12 سنة ولا حاجة. فبندخل النيدل وبعديها نعمل الابليشن. الجراوند جلاس اريا اللي حوالين الابليشن سوري دي انديكيت جود مش عارف بتحرك ازاي. دي الزون دي انديكيت ا جود ابليشن. وبناخد 5 تو 10 مليمتر اراوند از ا سيفتي مارجن. الجراوند جلاس هنا باينه كويس قوي بعد الابليشن على طول اللي حوالين الليجن. الناحيه الثانيه دخلنا نيدل ابليشن برضو الجراوند جلاس ابييرنس وبعدين كونسوليديشن افتر ووردز بعد يوم او اثنين. وبنعمل في سيم داي سيم سيشن بنعمل البيت سي تي. ولان لو استنينا بيحصل جرانيوليشن تيشو اكتيفيشن فبيبان كانه في اكتيفيتي although it's nothing it's just inflammatory change. فبنعملها في نفس اليوم زي ما احنا شايفين المفروض 20 minutes مش عارف. فانا خلاص قربت اخلص البري اند بوست ابليتيف. شايفين الصوره اللي على تحت على اليمين inert lesions instead of an active lesion before the ablation. برضو colon carcinoma two lung lesions. الاثنين دول صعبين شوية لأنهم أصغر وبيزل فبيتحركوا. أول واحدة والground glass حواريها وبعدين consolidation. الناحية الثانية أصعب شوية. استخدمنا السي تي فلوروسكوبي فيها لأنها لازقة في الدايفرانج بالضبط في حركتها كأنك بتصطاد سمك في مية. بالذات إن إحنا في الوقت ده بنكون قدرنا العيان نايم فهيز نوت كوبراتيف. وفي الآخر حرقنا ذيس ليجن وكونسوليديشن. كان في شوية نيوموثوركس اتسحبت. another case colon carcinoma two lingular lesions very tiny. المشكلة هنا إن one of them is so close to the cardiac muscle اللي فوق وبنحسس عليها وبنقدر نشوف بالمالتي بلانر ريكونستراكشن السجيتال والكورونال احنا فين عشان ما نخشش جوه الهارت. وبعدين كونسوليديشن بعديها وجراوند جلاس حوالين الليجن وبري وبوست ابليشن. الناحيه الشمال البري ميتابوليكالي اكتيف وبعدين انرت ليجن ات ذا اند. بنقف فين؟ بنقف 5 ملم ماكسيمم من الهارت ماسل لحسن يحصل نيكروزيس او اسكيميا. Outcomes is more or less the same like SBRT and metastatectomy with a high overall survival rate. Complications are more or less similar to biopsy. In conclusion, image-guided thermal ablations offers clinicians and a patient a repeatable, effective, low-cost, and safe treatment for effective palliation, or in many cases, complete cure of both primary and metastatic thoracic malignancies either before or concurrently with systemic chemotherapy. وأنا بفضل دايماً إن احنا we cover a little bit with chemotherapy after حتى الابليشن عشان نتأكد إن الأمور ماشية كويس وما حصلش أي ريكارز. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Wahid Tantawi, for this elegant presentation. أنا عندي سؤال بس في الميديستاينال ليمف نود بايوبسي.
أيوه.
لو حضرتك في اللنج كانسر مثلا لو في ميديستاينال ليمف نود وعاوز أخدها بايوبسي أحيانا كتير أنتوا بترفضوا. فإيه الكيسز اللي أنتوا يو دونت بريفير أنك أنتوا تاخدوها أو هل الحل هيبقى الميديستاينوسكوبي في الحالة دي؟
هو يعني most of the cases usually they have subcranial lymph node. إذا كان في سبكرانيال ليمف نود بمسافة 2 سنتي عشان أقدر أدخل الكور فدول كلهم بيتعملوا. الأنتيريور ميديستاينال كلهم بيتعملوا. المشكلة في الـ في الـ في الريترو كيفال بري تراكيال فدول بيبقوا عايزين ميديستاينوسكوبي لكن بقية الليمف نود معظمهم بنقدر ناخد. الهايلر مشكلتهم لو هم صغيرين هتقطع في ارتري فهيبقى صعب. لازم يبقوا كبار شويه عشان نتاكد ان احنا جوه ليجن ممكن يتاخد.
يعني الهايلر احنا ما نبعتهاش من الاول لحضرتك؟
لا الا لو كبيره شويه لو يعني كبيرة. لو هي بس تعدي 2 سم
اوكي
عشان اقدر اخش واقطع جواها ما تقطعش براها.
تمام.
البوستيريور ميديستاينال دي كلها تتعمل.
البوستيريور ميديستاينال والانتيريور ده سهل.
كلهم بتعمل.
لكن اللي هي اللي حضرتك يعني ما بتحبهاش.
اللي هي ريتروكيفال بريتراكيال دول صعبة انها تتعمل انليس هتعدي من اللنج كلها وتخرج منها التانية.
حاجة.
يعني انا كنت بعمل كده زمان بس لقيت ان ممكن سيفر ان نعمل سينوسكوبي.
تمام.
او ايبوس بقى لو كان يقدر يوصل لها ما اعرفش.
Thank you so much. في أي question?
Thank you, Professor Wahid. طبعا احنا مشرفين جدا طبعا بوجود حضرتك معنا as an international figure. أنا كنت بس عايز أسأل حضرتك with the advances in the CT slices, small slices, it didn't affect the size accessible to take a CT guided biopsy from lung lesion?
هو مشكلة small size إنه انا اقل حاجه اقدر اخدها 1.5 سنتي لو بنتكلم على الكور كلهم ممكن فاين نيدل مفيش مشكله ان فاين نيدل يتاخد منها وتعمل لها
من اقصد الكور
لكن الكور يعني انا باخد لحد سنتي 8 ملي اقل من كده بيبقى صعب قوي لانه مش هتجيب جود كور
يعني الليست 8 ملي
8 ملي
شكرا دكتور وحيد وشرف دكتور محمد اتفضل دكتور محمد
وبعدها البيت سيتي كان طالع اكتف وكان فعلا الكلام ان ده رياكتيفيشن ولا لا
هو يو هاف تو وذين 24 اورز دو ذا بيت سيتي لو تاخرنا عن كده للاسف مش اقل من 3 اشهر يمكن لحد 6 اشهر يفضل اكتف بياخد من 3 ل 6 شهور عشان يروح الاكتيفيتي
طيب الحاجه الثانيه هل في مشكله في التراك contamination بعد البيوبسي
اللنج لا اللنج يعني nobody proved ان في يعني implantation بعد البيوبسي او بعد اللنج يعني مش vascular قوي structure فانت وانت خارج ما تعملش seedling يعني مش زي بقيه الناس مش يعني بيج قصدي مش زي بقيه الاورجنز
يعني احنا عندنا الميزوسيوم
احنا بنتكلم على الابليشن مش كده لان البيوبسي صعب
احنا دايما في الميزس اليوم بيبقى السايت اوف بايوبسي بيحتاج نغطيه بالريدي ثيرابي
انا ادينت انكاونتر يعني محدش اشتكى ان احنا حتى في الميزس اليوم ناخد البايوبسي لان احنا برضو خلي بال حضرتك احنا بناخد فيري ثين 18 جيج ده رفيع قوي يعني فبالتالي الامبلانتيشن فيه بيبقى اقل بكتير قوي من الثيك نيدلز اللي ممكن تبقى
دكتور وحيد بعد اذن حضرتك دكتور وحيد بعد اذن حضرتك
نعم
هو نقدر ناخد مالتيبل كورز في اللنج ولا حاجه ناخد سنجل كور بس
باخد مالتيبل
باخد
مالتيبل
يعني مالتيبل انتريز مش بتعملش مشكله
لا مالتيبل انتريز بتزود هو في طريقتين ان احنا ناخد البايوبسي اول طريقه ان احنا نعمل كواكسيال سيستم بدخل حاجه اتخن من الكور اللي انا اخش عليه وبعدين اخش من جواها بالفاين نيدل واخد الفاين نيدل واغير المكان بتاعها بالانكلينيشن الحاجة التانية اللي أنا بستخدمها إن أنا بستخدم الكور نفسه الكور بايوبسي وطلع الستايلت وادخل الفاين نيدل وبعدين أخد الكور وأطلعه وأرجع النيدل مكانها وأغير واحدة تاني وتالت على حسب ما احنا عايزين المشكلة في النكروتيك تيومرز بيبقى صعب يعني مهما عملنا الكور دايما بيبقى أقل شوية بس كومباينيشن بتاع الفاين مع ال سيل بلوك مع التيشو بايوبسي الثلاثه مع بعض جنرالي بتجيب جود ريزلت
دكتور وحيد سؤال لحضرتك حضرتك قلت ان الابليشن كان بي ريبيتد
كان بي ريبيت
كان بي ريبيت يعني فور هاو ماني تايمز مثلا اقدر اعيد لو الليجن بقى ري
اول ما تكتشف ان هو ريكرنت
اول يعني ممكن اعيدها اكتر من مره
مفيش مشكله نفس المكان
طالما نفس المكان اقدر
نفس المكان هو واللوس بتاع التيشو مينيمال مش زي الريسكشن انت بتضطر تاخد حته حوالين التيشو اللوس مينيمال
والنمبر اوف ليجنز اللي كان بي ابليتد ان ذا سيم سيشن بالنسبه للنج ميتاس
نعم
يعني لو في لنج ميتاس هاو ميني ليجنز كان بي ابليتد
سؤال جميل هو احنا زي ما قلنا اكتر من 5 الشانس انه يبقى كومبليت كيور يوزوالي از يعني لو لكن ممكن يبقى adjuvant، يعني اساعد حضرتك في انك تقلل او لو في عندك ريزيستنت. عاده اللي بيتبعت لي مثلا اتعمل له خد كيمو ثيرابي لفتره طويله اتحسن قوي وفاضل اتنين قاعدين مكانه، فدول بتعمل لهم ابليش. بنعمل وان لانج ات ا تايم، يعني لو في ثلاثه اربعه في سيم لانج بنعملهم في نفس القعده، انما بعمل لانج دي عشان اسيب له واحده تاني لو حصل كومبليكيشن ليت كومبليكيشن يبقى عنده واحد تاني، وبعدين اشتغل على الثانيه بعد كده في انذر سيشن بعد ما اضمن ان الناحيه دي كويسه. شكرا.
Thank you so much.
شكرا
قوي. And we have now this next speaker will be Professor Mohammed Abdel Fattouh, Professor of Clinical Oncology and Head of Department of Manufaya University, Clinical Oncology of course. And the talk is about SBRT in early stage non-small cell lung cancer. Please, Professor.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اولا بشكر حضراتكم على الدعوه الكريمه، بشكر دكتور هشام ان هو دعاني ان انا اتكلم على الاس بي ار تي فور لانج كانسر. هو كونتينويشن للكلام دكتور وحيد، على الدكتور وحيد اتكلم على الثيرمال ابليشن، احنا هنتكلم على الابليشن بالراديوثيرابي. As you all know, non-small cell lung cancer represents around 80% of the cases of lung cancer. 20% of them are early stage, but unfortunately, many patients have some comorbidity, and because of the smoking history and they have cardiac problems, so they are not fit enough for surgical treatment. Initially, stereotactic ablative radiotherapy was limited to early stage primary lung cancer, but its use has now extended to oligometastatic setting as well as non-lung primary diseases like liver, spinal metastasis, and other organs. Evidence suggests that SABR is well tolerated and achieves a high rate of local control in multiple settings. It is now the standard of care for inoperable early stage non-small cell lung cancer, as I will discuss in the next slides. This study showed the SAPR for inoperable non-small cell lung cancer. For this cohort of patients, the median overall survival was 32.4 months for the whole group. And for the divided patient we have, because we know stage one can be T1 or T2 N0. For T1, it is better with 38.7 months compared in T2 to 24.5 months. This is for inoperable cases. And this study is based a study compared SAPR with conformal radiotherapy. And you can see here both treatment acts well for small tumor, but the difference is in the toxicity. The SAPR was have a lower toxicity profile with pneumonitis observed in 19% compared to 34% in 3D conformal radiotherapy, esophagitis in 8% compared to 30% in the other arm, and the quality of life was maintained throughout treatment as regard cough and dyspnea and other parameters of quality of life, while with conformal radiotherapy the quality of life deteriorated with time and the patient have dyspnea and cough. This mainly due to higher volume, treated volume with the concurrent 3D conformal radiotherapy. In this study, the median volume for SAPR was 75 cubic centimeter for the SAPR, and it was 185 millimeter for the 3D conformer. So this reflects the differences in the tumor volume. Its effectiveness in the and convenience and non-invasiveness led to substantial exploration as regard patient with operable disease. In this study from Japan, they treated patient with 48 gray in four fractions, both in operable and inoperable patients. And you can see here the operable patient have better survival at 3 years with 76.5% compared to almost 60% in the inoperable arm. Unfortunately, several trial aiming to address the use of surgery versus SPRT for patient with operable disease have failed to accrue, including RTOG 1021 and Rosel and the STARS and other studies. But in order to overcome this, they have done a pooled analysis for patient with STARS and Rosel trials and revealed that SAPRT was associated with significantly higher survival than lobectomy with mediastinal lymph node with 95% for the SAPR compared to 79% for surgery at 3 years. But however, this study has its limitations, a small number of patients, short follow-up, heterogeneity between study protocols, and lack of contemporary surgical techniques such as VATS and doing lobectomy and mediastinal lymphadenectomy using video-assisted thoracoscopic surgery. Then we have this trial. The STARS, they continued to accrue patients in the SAPR arm, and they have a comparative group of patients with same stage treated with surgery and VATS, and they compared both arms together by statistical methods, and they found that there was no significant difference between the two arms as regard overall survivor and progression-free survival with the SAPR arm 80 versus 88 in the progression-free, and both arms in the overall survival 91% compared together. In order to solve this problem, they have done this meta-analysis, including more than 3,000 patients from SAPR different studies. You can see here for the overall survival in 2 years, the SAPR has overall survival of 70% compared to 68% for the surgery arm, and for local control, the SAPR more than 90% of the patient had a local control at 2 years. The problem was SAPR is treating central lesions. We have different definitions for central and ultra-central tumors. This is the study by Timmerman et al. They defined the central zone as 2 centimeters of the proximal bronchial tree, including the lower 2 centimeters of the trachea, the carina, post bronchi, and bronchus intermedius, and lingular bronchus, and lower loop bronchus. They stopped the 2 centimeter margin at the segmental bronchi. And in this study from RTOG, Shang et al., they expanded this to include the heart and major vessels and the esophagus and the spinal cord in this definition. And from the Nordic group, they have this study called Helios. They included only the proximal bronchial tree and trachea and the main bronchi was 1 centimeter margin. So we have different definition for central located tumors in different studies. And this is the Helios study, as I mentioned, from the Nordic group. They compared patients, they treated patients with 7 grade times 8. And the local control at 6 months was 95%, and at 3 years it was 83%. And they divided patient into group A and group B. Group A was tumor less than 1 centimeter from the central bronchial tree, and group B more than 1 centimeter. The median was 5 millimeter for group A, and the median for group B was 20 millimeter, and there was no significant difference as a local control between the two groups. But the difference comes from grade 5 toxicity or grade 5 bleeding. They have 8 cases with hemopsis, grade 5 hemopsis, and you can see for the panel B, the group A, which is less than 1 centimeter from the central bronchial tree, have more patients with the grade 5 hemopsis. And they divided the patient from 0 to 5 millimeter, 6 to 10 millimeter, and more than 10 millimeter. And you can see in panel C, the best is the patient more than 1 centimeter from the central bronchial tree. This is how to contour it. They include, as I mentioned, the most inferior distal 2 centimeters from the trachea, carina, and right and left main bronchus, right and left upper lobe bronchus, the bronchus intermedius, and right middle lobe bronchus, lingular bronchus, and right and left lower lobe bronchus. Contouring of the lower bronchi will end immediately at the site of segmental bifurcation. And this is examples how to outline this. For doses, we have different doses according to the different scenarios. If we have a peripheral lesion, we have different dose. We have 54 gray in 18 gray per fraction, or 48 gray in 12 gray fraction, and 50 in 4, and 50 in 5. If we have central lesion, we have to reduce the dose and reduce fraction size. So we have 50 in 5, 70 in 10, 60 in 8 fraction, and 56 in 8 fractions. And this it's a bit busy slide. But you can follow the red arrow in order to check for the patient suitable for SAPRT or not. Here are the indications for SAPRT on the left-hand side, and the box immediately beside it is the contraindication. And if you have any of these spinal cord or brachial plexus or esophagus limitation, then the patient is not fit for SAPR. Then you can follow the red arrow. If you are not close to the no-fly zone or the proximal bronchial tree, and then if you are more than 2 centimeters, not more than less than 2 centimeters from the mediastinum, then you can check if you overlap the chest wall or diaphragm. If not, then you can treat with 54 gray and 3. If you approaching or the chest wall but not the diaphragm, you can give 48 and 3. If you approach the diaphragm, you have to reduce the dose 60. In 5, this is the blue box. For others, you can use different doses. Mainly, you have to reduce the dose in order to keep the organ at risk and don't have any complication with treatment. And this is two examples, one for peripheral lesion treated with ARC therapy and was with central lesion. You can see the proximal bronchial tree is outlined in the second image. And this is how you track, you need to have some gating in order to treat the patient because you don't have big margin like 3D conformal radiotherapy and your gross tumor volume is your CTV and you add only 10 millimeter or 5 to 10 millimeter in order to have the BTV and you have this infrared camera and infrared illuminator and the box with dots that reflect the infrared and the camera can detect the respiratory movement. Like this, you put the box at the chest wall in front of the patient, and then you have a software that can detect certain phases of the respiratory cycle and can only treat the patient with limited movement. So you ensure that the volume always in the field of your treatment. And this is equivalent dose in alpha, when you use alpha beta ratio, biological effective dose. If you you can see if you use 58 and 8 or 54 and 3, you increase the biological effective dose more than 100 gray. It reaches up to 150 with 54 and 3 fractions. The other doses, as I mentioned, used in central lesion, you have to reduce the dose in order to have not to have a significant complication. And this is the UK consensus on normal tissue dose volume constraints. You can have the reference and check they have these different structures. If you are going to treat with SABRT with one fraction or three fraction, five fraction, or eight fraction, and for each fractionation, you will have the dose constraint. You can get the reference and do it. My take-home message, and this is my final slide, SABR is now standard of care for inoperable early-stage non-small cell lung cancer. The use of SABR for operable early stages is promising and need further study. SABR requires vigorous quality assurance program, a stringent selection criteria to avoid small but significant complications. And by that, I end my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mohamed Mfetouh. If anyone have any question? Okay, thank you, Professor. Thank you. Now I'm greatly honored to present my dear friend, Professor Mohamed Alameddine. He's going to talk about the paradigm of ALK inhibitors in metastatic non-small cell lung cancer.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Dr. Hisham al-Wakil, Dr. Lubna Aiz al-Araf, for the invitation. And switching gears from thermal ablation and local ablation, either by interventional radiologist or SBRT, to systemic treatment that also works on targeting the lesions without harm to the normal tissue by using targeted systemic treatment. My talk today will be on the management of ممكن بعد إذنك My talk today will be on the management of advanced non-small cell lung cancer, the ALK positive tumors. And here is my disclosure. And as you all know, the lung cancer is the second most commonly cancer diagnosed worldwide. And it's the first leading cause of cancer mortality worldwide. So what about in Egypt? The fifth most commonly diagnosed cancer and the fourth leading cause of death for the cancer-related mortality in Egypt. The prevalence of non-small cell lung cancer, we have almost 85 to 90% of lung cancers are non-small cell lung cancer. We have only 10 to 15% with small cell lung cancer. Subtypes, we have adenocarcinoma, large cell carcinoma, and the squamous cell carcinoma represent the most common types of the non-small cell lung cancer. As you all know, in all cancers, the cancer survival is largely linked to the stage at diagnosis. So for stage 3 disease, only 1/3 of your patient would be living at the time of 5 years. As you can see in the graph on the right side, for patient with stage 3A, almost 36% of the patient would be surviving at 5 years. If you can see here, lung cancer has evolved from single disease to by histological subtypes to more range of diseases by the oncodriver mutation that could be existing either in the adenocarcinoma or in the squamous cell carcinoma. The development of multiple targeted therapies has changed the treatment landscape of advanced small lung cancer, and we have multiple mutations. We have the EGFR mutations, we have the RAS mutation, the BRAF, the MET, the RET, and the topic of our presentation today, the ALK mutation. Here is the NCCN guidelines on the initial management if you have a case of non-small cell lung cancer. And then if you have the pathology, either the adenocarcinoma or the squamous cell carcinoma, you should test your patient for molecular testing for the oncogene driver mutation, and also test your patient for the PD-L1 expression for the use of immunotherapy. So per guidelines, if you have the patient with non-small cell lung cancer, either adenocarcinoma or squamous cell carcinoma, you should test your patient for the molecular driver mutations and also for the PD-L1 expression for the use of immunotherapy. The topic of our presentation, the ALK positive disease, around 5% of patients with advanced non-small cell lung cancer will have ALK rearrangement in 5% cases of the cases of non-small cell lung cancer. What is the story of the ALK gene? ALK membrane is ALK is a membrane-bound protein with intra and extracellular domain. By binding to the growth factors, the MK or the PTN, they have what we call, by binding to the ligand, the growth factors, the MK or PTN, we have signaling pathway and phosphorylation of the intracellular domain of the ALK gene. And by phosphorylation of the intracellular part, we have signaling, and this signaling leading to proliferation and the cell survival. So this is the wild type ALK. The ALK gene actually is may play an important role in the CNS development and the early embryological growth. And in the normal tissue, it is not usually present in the lung tissue. So what happens in the ALK fusion rearrangement? I mean, we have the fusion of EML4 ALK is localized within the cytoplasm, and these attach it to the ALK domain. And by the attachment of the EML4 to the ALK domain, this leads to activation of the ALK pathway, and then phosphorylation, and then signaling, leading to cell growth and tumor proliferation. So ALK fusion partner mediate ligand-independent activation of ALK and constitute kinase activity in the EML4 ALK fusion protein by activation through the pathway, which leading to proliferation and survival of the malignant cells. As we've just said, I mean, the most common rearrangement for the ALK gene is the EML4 fusion, and by the fusion of the EML4 and the ALK protein, we have the rearrangement, and we have this ALK fusion gene leading to the proliferation and the tumor growth. The most common rearrangement for the ALK fusion is the EML4 fusion, and also within the EML4 fusion, we have many variants we have many variants within the same fusion. That means even within the same disease, we having a multiple disease. This could explain the resistance that we are treating when you're treating a patient with non-small cell lung cancer. And because even in the ALK fusion gene, you might have multiple variants of the fusion gene within the same category. Patient with ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer present with advanced disease, usually aggressive disease, usually at a younger age, almost 50 years old of age. And most commonly, 30% of the patient would have CNS mets at the time of presentation, and 5% of those patients would have more than brain lesions at the time of the first imaging. Typical characteristics, usually younger, as we've just mentioned, never or late smokers, adenocarcinoma histology is the most common, and usually, again, advanced disease at the time of diagnosis, pleural or pericardial effusion, multiple lesions, and CNS mets. We have four approved ALK inhibitors for the first-line treatment for advanced ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. We have the crizotinib by the PROFILE trial, and we have the seretinib by the SND4 trial, and we have the alectinib by the ALEX trial, and we have brigatinib by the ALTA trial. All of these approved as a first-line treatment for ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. Also, we have the third generation. We have the lorlatinib by the Crown study, approved also as a first-line treatment for ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. Here is the first-generation ALK inhibitor. We have, again, the PROFILE study. We have randomization to crizotinib versus chemotherapy, and we have a higher efficacy for the crizotinib. We have PFS of 10.9 months as compared to 7 months for the chemotherapy arm. Here is the second generation ALK inhibitors. We have the seretinib. The seretinib also was tried versus chemotherapy, and again proved the efficacy for the ALK positive. We have the PFS here, this one to the left, upper left corner. The seretinib, we have PFS of 16.6 months as compared to 8.1 months for the chemotherapy arm. We have also the enzaretinib. The enzaretinib, we have improved the PFS to 25.8 months as compared to 20.7 months for the crizotinib arm. As you can see here, if you look at the hazard ratio of all ALK inhibitors, we have consistent improvement of the PFS, almost 50% reduction at the risk of disease progression when using ALK inhibitors as first-line treatment in ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. Here is the third generation ALK inhibitors, even more improvement. Here is the lorlatinib. Lorlatinib was tried versus crizotinib, and we have more and more improvement in the BFS. We have hazard ratio of 0.27. This was unprecedented improvement in the BFS results when using the third generation ALK inhibitors in the treatment of non-small cell lung cancer, which expressing the ALK positive or the ALK fusion gene. Here is the list or the summary of the progression-free survival benefit of the first-line ALK inhibitors. As you can see here, also the alectinib. The alectinib also is a very good choice as a first-line treatment. As approved by the ALEX trial, we have a PFS of 34.8 months as compared to crizotinib, which is the first generation. Here is the three trials of the alectinib. Alectinib, we have three phase three trials leading to the first approval or the approval of alectinib as first line treatment for ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer, which was first approved in the U.S. in November 2017 and in Europe in December 2017. Based on the primary data from the pivotal trial, the ALEX trial. The ALEX trial was a phase three trial, was a global randomized trial, open label, and the randomization was to alectinib versus crizotinib. And here is the results of the ALEX trial, improvement of the BFS for the alectinib arm of 34.8 months as compared to the 10.9 months for the crizotinib, and we have hazard ratio of 0.43. Here is the PFS benefit with alectinib. As you can see, the PFS improvement was consistent among all the patient subgroups. Here is the CNS protection from the alectinib arm. As you can see, at 4 years, we have 38% of alectinib-treated patients with CNS mets at the baseline did not showing any progressive disease. That is very important because when you have the patient with CNS mets at presentation, almost half of your patient would not have progression at the time of four years from using alectinib as first-line treatment. Here is the high durable systemic response. We have a systemic response of almost 83%, and this response is durable response maintained for almost 33 months. That is very assuring for the clinicians. I mean, you have very high response reaching up to 83%, and this response is durable, lasting up to 35 months. What about the overall survival data? PFS benefit was approved for the all the ALK inhibitors. What about the overall survival data? Also trending positivity for alectinib versus crizotinib. And if you look at the delay the time until CNS progression versus the crizotinib arm in the intention to treat population, and you can see that treatment with alectinib lead to 84% reduction in the risk of CNS progression as the first progression event. Again, looking at the CNS protection, and as you all know, CNS progression or CNS develop, CNS metastatic lesions development is a nightmare for us as a clinician when treating a patient with a bronchogenic carcinoma. Again, alectinib prolong the time until the development of CNS mets and also delays the time of progression of this existing CNS metastatic disease. Here again, concluding the CNS protection, the overall response rate, the CNS overall response rate is 81% as compared to 50% for the crizotinib arm. What about the complete response? 38% complete response rate for the alectinib arm versus only 5% for the crizotinib arm. Here is the toxicity profile, no safety signals for the drug. Despite this drug was for treating the patient up to 5 years, no safety signals for this drug, the alectinib, in ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. So for the alectinib, we have systemic efficacy, we have CNS protection, and we have favorable safety and tolerability profiles. So in the NCCN guidelines, we have alectinib as preferred line of treatment in ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. And also the ESMO clinical practice guidelines give the alectinib the highest level of recommendation with the highest magnitude of clinical benefit scale score of 4. What about the third generation, the Lorbrena, about the, or the lorlatinib, the Crown trial, randomization trial, phase 3, which number of patients, 200 patients, 96, randomization to Lorbrena, 100 milligram once daily, or crizotinib, 200 milligram twice daily, and the primary endpoint was the progression-free survival. And here is the results for the Crown trial. Again, the huge improvement in the BFS, reaching with the hazard ratio of 0.28, which was very significant improvement for the BFS. Here is the superior progression-free survival with lorlatinib versus crizotinib. We have 72% reduction in the risk of disease progression or death as compared to crizotinib as first-line treatment. Here is the, also the CNS protection is always very significant when using lorlatinib as first line. We have overall response rate as 76.8%. As you can, you might notice that the overall response rate for the CNS is a slight lower than the alectinib. But again, this is a very high response rate when you're looking at the CNS response rate. And again, we have 82% intracranial overall response rate in patients with measurable brain mets at the base line. So for lorlatinib, we have a first line, which is you could use it also as a first line using the most effective drug, which is very important for us as a clinician, because I mean, we always debating, should we use all first as a first line, and upon progression, you should go for the second generation or the third generation. I mean, the recommendation to go for the best drug from the first shot, because using the most effective drug from the first shot, this would give your patient the best chance, because
first line treatment may be the only line of treatment your patient might receive. You are not sure if you start with the first generation and you go for the second generation, your patient would survive to receive the second or the third generation. What else about the lorlatinib? Strong efficacy along all the patient parameters. I mean, as you've just mentioned, we have PFS improvement, and this PFS improvement was consistent among all the patient subgroups. We have also high CNS response rate, and we have good tolerability and proper toxicity profile. So lorlatinib also should be considered as first-line treatment for ALK positive. And here is the most common adverse event for the first-line ALK inhibitors. For the alectinib, the constipation is the most common side effect. For seretinib, diarrhea is the most common. For the crizotinib, vision disorders noticed in almost 71% of the patient. And for brigatinib, we have the diarrhea as the most common adverse event. What about the enzaretinib? We have the rash, and we have lorlatinib. We have the hyperlipidemia, and here is the dose adjustment. If your patient is receiving lorlatinib and you check on the lipid profile and you see hyperlipidemia, here is the guidelines for dose reduction according to the rise of lipid profile. So for advanced ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer, your typical patient journey starts with the first-line treatment. Usually you have a good response in 74 to 83%. At the development, at the time of development of resistance to the first line, you go for the second line until disease progression. Here is the NCCN guidelines, the ALK rearrangement. The ALK rearrangement should be tested. And if you already started your patient on a treatment protocol, you could continue your treatment protocol, either two or three courses of chemotherapy. And then if your patient is having ALK positive, you could shift your patient on the ALK inhibitors, or you could discontinue the pre-estimated treatment protocol and shift your patient to the ALK inhibitors. What if you started on the first generation and then you're having progression at one time? If your patient is having asymptomatic progression, you could continue the first generation and try a local treatment. And if you there is symptomatic progression, you could shift for the second or the third generation. This is a little different from the EGFR. When you start with the first generation anti-EGFR drugs, you could not go for the second generation unless you have certain type of mutations. But for the ALK mutation, if you started in the first generation and you have some progression at the time, let's say of 10 months on using the first generation, you could go for the second or the third generation. Or if you're having asymptomatic progression, you could also try the local treatment. Here is just some highlights from the last ESMO, the topic of our presentation today about the management of ALK-positive metastatic. But here is the highlights from the last ESMO talking about the adjuvant ALK-positive fusion. And here is the results of the ALINA trial published in the last ESMO, looking at the results of the adjuvant ALK inhibitors, resected stage 1B up to stage 3A ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer, and randomization to alectinib 600 milligram twice daily for 2 years, no chemotherapy at all. Also, unlike the anti-EGFR, when you use it in the adjuvant setting, you start first with two or three courses of chemotherapy and then go for the anti-EGFR. But for the ALK-positive, you go straight ahead to the ALK inhibition. Randomization 1-to-1 to the platinum-based chemotherapy. And as you can see here, is the patient demographics and the characteristics. And here is the disease-free survival from stage 2 to stage 3A. Huge improvement in the PFS, even after discontinuation of the drug at 24 months. Here, as you can see, the improvement even in the 36 months after discontinuation of alectinib at 24 months. And also in the intention to treat population, if you include patients from stage 1B up to 3A, again, you have huge improvement of the BFS, and we have hazard ratio of 0.24. And very important, again, you have the improvement even at 36 months, even after discontinuation of the drug at 24 months. Here is the improvement was consistent among all the patient subgroups, and here is the disease-free survival by stage, proven efficacy of alectinib as adjuvant treatment across all the patient subgroups, even for the patient with stage 1B. Also, the CNS survival, again, was also improved when using alectinib as adjuvant treatment. We have hazard ratio of 0.22. And here is the site of disease recurrence. As you can see for the brain, we have huge rise of the CNS recurrence rate for the chemotherapy arm versus the alectinib arm. Here is the safety summary. Again, no safety signals for alectinib as adjuvant treatment. And we have also another key trials of alectinib for the early stage as an adjuvant treatment. We are still waiting for these results to establish the development of adjuvant ALK-positive drugs as an adjuvant treatment for resected non-small cell lung cancer ALK-positive. And the result, the summary of the ALINA trial, the first and the only positive phase 3 trial of an ALK inhibition in resected stage 1B, stage 3A non-small cell lung cancer. Treatment with adjuvant alectinib resulted in a statistically significant and clinically meaningful improvement in the DFS compared with chemotherapy arm. We have a hazard ratio of 0.24, improvement of the CNS disease-free survival, and the adjuvant alectinib was tolerable and with accepted toxicity profile. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Mohammed, for the very presentation as usual. I think for the sake of time, we are going to postpone the questions. Okay. Thank you so much. Now it's my pleasure and honor to introduce Professor Hisham El-Wakil, Professor of Clinical Oncology at Ain Shams University. And the topic is maintenance treatment in non-small cell lung cancer.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, thank you very much for the chairpersons. Thank you, Dr. Nirvana, for the kind introduction. Today, my topic is about maintenance therapy in metastatic non-small cell lung cancer. This is my disclosure. As you can see from the diagram, this is a GlobalCan 2020. The number of new cases in Egypt in both sexes, as we can see here, lung cancer is the fifth most common type. While in males, it is the third most common malignancy with around 4,800 new cases per year. Lung cancer facts. It is the most common cause of cancer-related mortality in US. It accounts for more deaths than breast, prostate, and colorectal cancer combined. Histologically and molecularly is a heterogeneous disease. Unfavorable stage distribution at the time of diagnosis. More than 25 to 30,000 never smoking Americans will develop lung cancer every year. Why maintenance therapy? كلنا عارفين ان احنا دايما بنبدا في حالات الميتاستاتيك نان سمول سيل لان كانسر ويز كيموثيرابي. وي كان نوت بروسيد فور كيموثيرابي مور ذان 6 سايكلز يوجوالي بيكوز اوف كيوميلاتيف توكسيسيتي. فده كان الكونسبت بتاع المينتنس ثيرابي. افتر اتشيفينج جود ريسبونس ويز فيرست لاين كيموثيرابي وي ويل اوميت وان اور مور دراجز اند كيپ ذا بيشنت اون وان اور مور دراجز. If we continued with one of the drugs used in first line, it is called continuation maintenance. If we shifted to another agent, it is switch maintenance. So downshifting to less a challenging but still effective therapy. As we all know, we cannot proceed for chemotherapy for a long time because of cumulative toxicity, as I mentioned, like fatigue, like peripheral neuropathy, like pancytopenia. Maintenance therapy can be applied with chemotherapy or targeted therapy or immunotherapy. Let us start with maintenance by chemotherapy. This is this trial is Avapel trial. which was published in 2009 in the Journal of Clinical Oncology. It is a phase 2 study of pemetrexed plus carboplatin plus BEVA with maintenance with BEVA and pemetrexed in patients with non-squamous metastatic non-small cell lung cancer. This is the design of the trial. After receiving 4 lines of chemotherapy, 4 cycles of chemotherapy, patients who did not progress were randomized between BEVA or BEVA plus BEMI. As we can see here, there is very nice separation of both curves, and the results are in favor of pemetrexed plus BEVA. The progression-free survival is 7.4 versus 3.7. This means mainly تقريباً الدبل يعني. Another trial, which is a point break. In this trial, we used pemetrexed carbo-BEVA as compared to paclitaxel carbo-BEVA, and patients in the first arm were maintained on pemetrexed BEVA, and patients in the second arm were maintained on BEVA only. Again, as we can see here, there is a good separation of the two curves in progression-free survival and overall survival in favor of patients who received BEMI-BEVA as maintenance therapy. Now I'll shift to maintenance by targeted therapy. This is a Saturn study, which is a multicentric randomized placebo-controlled trial. Patients again received platinum doublet, and after 4 cycles, patients were randomized between erlotinib 150 milligram once daily versus placebo. As we can see here, around 800 or more than 880 patients were analyzed, 437 in each arm, and progression-free survival was assessed in all patients and in patients with EGFR mutation. The progression-free survival and overall survival for patients who received erlotinib as maintenance are better than placebo in all patients, and especially in patients with EGFR mutation. Subgroup analysis of Asian patients, again, the benefit was maintained for all patients and patients who had the mutation. Let us move to maintenance by immunotherapy. We have the EMPOWER 150 trial, which is a randomized trial. Patients were randomized into 3 arms. Arm A received atezo carbo BEVA, and arm B atezo carbo BEVA paclitaxel, and arm C carbo bacli and BEVA. Patients in arm A were maintained on atezo, arm B atezo BEVA, and arm C BEVA only. If we compared arm C with arm B, the results are in favor of arm B, who received atezo BEVA as maintenance. This regards the progression-free survival, and the benefit was maintained among all subgroup analyzed. Again, the overall response rate and duration of response also are in favor of arm B. The overall survival also show the same trend of magnitude benefit for arm B. Survival benefit was maintained across all PD-L1 subgroups, whether high expressors or intermediate or even PD-L1 negative group. So the EMPOWER 150, the overall survival updated analysis again showed the same results. Now I'll speak about the KEYNOTE 189 trial, which assessed the results of Bembro plus chemo, and patients in the first arm were maintained on Bembro as maintenance therapy plus pemetrexed, and patients in the second arm received placebo plus BEMI. The patients who received pemetrexed Bembro showed greater benefit as regards the overall survival in PD-L1 group less than 1%, as we can see from the figure. 4-year follow-up of progression-free survival in PD-L1 between 1 to 49%, the benefit is still maintained. 4-year follow-up of progression-free survival in PD-L1 negative. Again, the results are still in favor of Bembro plus Bimetrix. Final analysis, again, all subgroup analysis or subgroup analyzed show the same benefit. 5-year update analysis of Keynote 180. As we can see here, after 5 years, still the results are in favor of bemetrexed plus bemi plus bembro. Again, the progression-free survival also show the same trend. So in conclusion, within 5 years follow-up, bembro plus bemi maintained an overall survival and progression-free survival benefit. Consistent with previous reports, toxicity was manageable. Patients who completed 35 cycles, means 2 years of bembro, experienced durable responses, and 72% of them are still alive after 3 years of completion of 35 cycles of bembro. Another trial is a Keynote 407. It is a phase 3 study of carbo-Beckley or nab-Beckley plus minus bembro as first line, but in patients with squamous cell metastatic non-small cell lung cancer, and patients in the first arm were maintained on bembro, and patients on the second arm were maintained on placebo. Final analysis of overall survival in patients with PD-L1 less than 1%, the results are in favor of bembro. Progression-free survival show the same trend also. Final analysis of progression-free survival too, again, the results are still in favor of bembro maintenance. 5-year update analysis of the Keynote 407 trial. As we can see here, there is still very good separation of both curves, and the hazard ratio is 0.71. This means 29% risk reduction. For progression-free survival, the hazard ratio is 0.62. This means 38% risk reduction. So in conclusion, for the Keynote 407 trial, again, within 5 years of follow-up, bembro plus chemo maintained an overall survival and progression-free survival benefit versus placebo plus chemo. Toxicity was manageable and consistent with the prior reports. Patients who completed 35 cycles of bembro had durable response and experienced long-term overall survival. Long-term data continue to support bembro plus chemo as a standard of care first-line treatment option for metastatic squamous non-small cell lung cancer. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Hisham, for your illustrative and comprehensive presentation. And now we come to the last talk in our session, will be presented virtually by Professor Hoschmeier, and the talk will be on management of non-oncogenic addicted advanced non-small cell lung cancer in 2023. Dear
colleagues, thank you very much for the great invitation. Unfortunately, it's holiday time at the time of the meeting, and therefore I want to present my talk virtually pre-recorded. I'm really sorry, but it wouldn't be otherwise manageable. Thank you very much still for the invitation. My talk is about the patients with non-driver mutations, so management of non-oncogene addicted advanced non-small cell lung cancer. We had a huge development, just an example, from the ASCO this year, where you saw in the last decades, 2000-2010, not a huge development, but in the last 10 years, a huge step forward, mainly based that we got the better survival with the immunotherapy. And this is mainly the focus I have to present also. When I started in the 90s, each patient received the same treatment. All patients with lung cancer received chemotherapy. Nowadays, we know that we have to separate patients in different groups, and we have to plan the treatment more and more individually. We know there's not one type of lung cancer. We know EGFR, ALK, ROS1, and also rare mutations, like you can see HER2, NTRK, ROS, BREF, RET, are rare mutations. But the group of rare mutations is also huge. And at the end, only at least in our center, 40%, 50% have no driver in this situation. We had a fast development in the last decades. So when we look here, EGFR, ALK, ROS1, BREF, and the group where we don't find a driver, and that this is mainly the group I have to focus on in this talk, but is getting smaller and smaller. Only when we test before and decide then what needs the patient, then we can decide the better treatment, and this can lead then to a better overall survival. Here is the treatment algorithm: past chemotherapy, now also immunotherapy, also targeted therapy. The new drugs are now bispecific monoclonal antibodies like amivantamab, mainly for the EGFR mutated patients, available antibody drug conjugates. Here, I would say trastuzumab deruxtecan is already labeled in our country since January next year. We can use it. Datotumab deruxtecan at the end, I will show you some data. Also, a new generation is coming up that you combine bispecific antibodies with an anti-drug conjugate. Then we have a mixture of both new drugs here. This is how we treat nowadays our patients. We decide, is there a driver mutation or no driver mutation? And I will mainly focus on no driver in this talk, but the group is getting smaller and smaller, where we really don't find anything in the situation. These are our first data, sorry for the typo here, first data about the LaLuca registry, where you see 800 patients measured in about a little bit more than 1 year. From our center, you see patients, male and female, are quite similar. A lot of patients are smokers, only a few are never smokers. But here I want to focus here, it means staging here in German, that you unfortunately, in our center, the majority of the patients are coming already in the local advanced or advanced staging. 50% around are stage 4, and the stage 3 patients, that is a very heterogeneous group, is also 1/4. And we have to get better, especially in detecting lung cancer earlier and also moving these treatments into the earlier lines to avoid a recurrence and treat the patients better in this situation. How long does the patient take to come to our clinic? First symptoms, you see 47 days. Then the first contact in our hospital, and then it's going fast. The first NGS report, pathological report, is here in 15 days. And this means high quality. That means that when we get in contact, that we can offer very fast a treatment. The majority in our center are adenocarcinoma. Non-squamous are mainly adenocarcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, small cell lung cancer is going down. The patients who are not into a one group are not otherwise specified. The PD-L1 status of our patients is lower. The group of negative PD-L1 patients is low, but is relatively high. So the treatment that we have to detect treatments here is important in this situation. We have in nearly 98.5%, we have an NGS report, and you see in around 50%, we don't see anything in the NGS report. A lot of patients, at least in our center, have a KRAS mutation. The half of these patients have the KRAS G12C mutation, where we can also treat with sotorasib. If we test the patient in early stage or later stage, the NGS report is the same. So there's no difference that we should test more or less. From my side, we should test everybody. We have ADAURA to have to give patients osimertinib in the adjuvant setting. We have the label for now also alectinib in the altranslocated patients. We have a study running with RET fusion positive patients receiving selpercatinib against placebo in the adjuvant setting. So it's important that we offer our patients also in early staging an NGS test and treat these patients in this situation. But my talk is mainly focusing on the later stages without any driver in this situation. Here an example, 62 years old male patient, huge tumor mass on both sides. We have different options. We can treat with CheckMate 227, CheckMate 9LA, even cemiplimab with the Empower regimen. Also now also available Poseidon, at least. We have data to use here, chemotherapy plus durvalumab plus temozolomab, mainly in the KRAS mutated patients, because we have here just a label for the KRAS mutated patients. I didn't put it here in this situation. And we decided here carboplatin, pemetrexed, pembrolizumab. And you see in this patient an enormous response in, and you see how excellent these drugs can work in this situation. The basis for this publication or the basis for this treatment is this publication from journal from the New England Journal of Medicine. Here we have the first publication, as it already 4,500 citations, just to show how important this publication is. Here patient received without an EGFR and ALK translocation. From my point of view, you should include at least ROS1. MET, I would say, it's not clear. RET, we saw at the ESMO that immunotherapy doesn't work really, so I would also here exclude RET fusion positive patients. KRAS just have a worse outcome, but they can also respond clearly better to chemo IO in this situation. Here, there is, the randomization was 2-1, pembro plus chemo against chemotherapy alone, and what is an important point is that a crossover was allowed. And in a lot of trials, when we look at CheckMate, when we look at the Empower studies, a crossover was not allowed. So you cannot say what is better, sequencing or not. Only if you give in the crossover arm immunotherapy automatically, what is standard, you can really compare OS data in this situation. OS was astonishing. 5-year overall survival, 20% against 11%. So it's clearly better to use immunotherapy in all groups, independent of the PD-L1 staining in all patients. Here also the support that we should use it in all patients in this situation. Also here, the tumor response. What is also important for the neoadjuvant treatment strategies that we have nearly doubled or three times higher overall survival, overall remission rates, that we can lead here with combination chemo IO to a better situation. Here, the data also, here some patient examples, a patient who is already living a very long time, first diagnosis, here you can see in 2016, huge liver metastasis, huge axillary lymph nodes, and you can see here with chemo IO, up with 50% PD-L1 staining, nearly complete remission, and also here in the liver metastasis, like you can see here, astonishing result with a complete remission. The patient is still alive after 7 years and is still under control in the study. Another patient here, you can see a 62-year-old female patient, a metastasis here on the right side, left side, the tumor. Also, one disease, T3N1M1A, and you can see we can discuss in this limited disease situations or oligometastatic disease, we can discuss which one is the right treatment, surgery on both sides, radiotherapy, on both, systemic treatment, and we decided to start with immunotherapy alone in this situation, and you can see here a very nice remission for the patient. Then we said good remission, T3, N1, M1B, M1A, clear good response, and we went for a lobectomy on the left side. We went for a straight radiotherapy on the right side, and we always see more and more after immunotherapy these astonishing results in terms of the pathological response. Here, the patient is already now more than 5 years in a remission with a metastatic disease, makes her very, very happy in this situation. Same data with pembrolizumab with squamous cell carcinoma patients. Same strategy in terms of treatment. The different here, we used here carboplatin paclitaxel. Normally, we use a little lower dosing here of carboplatin AOC5 and paclitaxel 175 milligrams. And also the crossover was allowed. You can see here that the curves are not crossing and have a clear leading to an overall survival. Also here, the remission rates are astonishing and clearly better for the combination. Here we can also share a case since 3 years in remission, PD-L1 staining negative, 100 back years. Normally we know that these patients are frailer, and normally I cannot do the whole treatment, the whole chemotherapy for these patients because the response is not optimal. What I also want to highlight, the importance to combine immunotherapy with radiotherapy. Here, patient with a tumor here on the right lower lobe and a bone metastasis here on the right side. And you can see here, we have different options, especially in the metastatic area also. But normally we combine immunotherapy with the radiotherapy. And you can see here that the remission of the tumor with this completely destroyed lung in the right side led to a very nice remission in this situation. Plus, you can see here the response also in combination with the radiotherapy is leading to excellent results in this situation. We can give immunotherapy alone. Everybody is aware of the KEYNOTE-024 trial with this very long survival and overall survival benefit. Should we use chemo and IO? Normally we do it also in patients with higher PD-L1 staining above 50. When there's 90 or 100, we use it alone. But in these patients, normally we use chemotherapy and pembrolizumab in these patients with high tumor load, etc. PFS seems to be also clearly better in this situation. What we have to be aware that the response can be sometimes different. Here, a patient from the KEYNOTE-024 trial, you see here the tumor on the left side, liver metastasis. With the treatment, the tumor exploded initially after 4 weeks, and this can be sometimes a pseudoprogression. The pseudoprogression is normally extremely fast. You can do a rebiopsy to understand, is this real tumor? Yes, there can be a lot of tumor, there can be a lot of inflammation to get a better explanation here in this situation, like in this KEYNOTE-024 patient, where we saw 1 month later in the first month, heavy progression, and after another 1 month, a clear regression. We have to say with chemo-IO, it's rarer to see the pseudoprogression, but it can happen. And therefore, here is just an example how the different responses can happen. Pseudoprogression, hyperprogression is normally, from my point of view, not so often seen, mainly when there's in the first month a progression, then it's more or less the pseudoprogression. When we do a response assessment, don't do it after 4 or 6 weeks, then we can see a lot of immune-related or immune cells in this situation, lymphocytes, lymph node expansion in this situation. And when you're unclear, please do a rebiopsy to understand it. Normally, we see it more or less in the lymph nodes, like a sarcoid-like reaction, like we published it here. Which other possibilities do we have? Immunotherapy alone with atezolizumab. Here in the updated analysis, we didn't see an overall survival benefit in comparison to pembro. So even a crossover was not allowed, so we don't use it. Then we have the cemiplimab data that are also not looking fine in this situation, especially for the squamous cell carcinoma patients. The problem here is always that this testing of the PD-L1 staining was different, and you have to follow up here different patient types. What we have to say is for cemiplimab that we really could see here the higher PD-L1 staining, the better the remission, the better the outcome for the patient. So it matters also 50 or 80 or 100% PD-L1 staining. And at the end of the talk, for the last some minutes, I want to share with you this data with datotumab deruxtecan to cover also this next second line possibilities. Datotumab deruxtecan is an antidrug conjugate with a blocking here and is going to the DATO receptor in this situation. And recently at the ESMO, we saw data about DATO against docetaxel in patients with actionable or without actionable genomic driver in the situation. So at least one chemo IO had to be given, and the and no available TKI. And we saw 300 against 300 patients in different lines in the situation, non-squamous and also squamous. And the outcome when we was positive, the whole group, but in the primary endpoint, but is it also clinically meaningful? And you see here a result of 4.4 against 3.7 months in this situation against docetaxel. Docetaxel performed not bad, but I would say better than we are used to, I would say. Dato with 4.4 better. Also, overall remission rate and duration of response. But then we saw data more. We looked into this data more deeply, and we saw squamous here. And you see squamous don't have any clear efficacy of datotumab. And when we look here then deeper into the details, we see a clear difference of around 2 months PFS depth difference and in the nearly three times higher overall remission rate. In overall survival, when you separate between non-squamous and squamous, you see a clear benefit also for the non-squamous. Unfortunately, only 0.1 point made the difference for a statistically significance for the non-squamous. So I see a clear benefit with datotumab for the non-squamous in these patient groups. Sure, we see some new side effects, more other adverse events. We can have hematological, neutropenia side effects, gastrointestinal side effects, but especially the stomatitis, ocular events, and the ILD is something new we have to see in this situation. Here's the summary from last week about the summary from datotumab deruxtecan, and for me, the summary, a potential new meaningful treatment for our patients. Where do we put this data? Is it a new standard in second line? We use it more or less in the first line setting, that we combine it with immunotherapy, with chemo IO in the situation, and here we really see astonishing results for our patients. So I don't see clearly the role only in second line. This is perhaps the next step where the company is going to offer it to our patients in setting, but more or less it will come also in first line. So this is our treatment schedule in no drivers, exclude initially any mutation, and when we have no driver, immuno or immunotherapy plus chemotherapy in first line, and datotumab is a new chance for our patients. Dankeschön from Vienna. Thank you very much. And I hope there are some questions that can be answered by my colleague in this situation. Thank you. Bye.
And by this, we will close the session of metastatic lung cancer. Thanks for the chairpersons and thanks for the audience. And moving now to the next session for the Novartis Symposium.